was just a child when I felt the Savior leading. I was drawn to what I could not understand. And for the cause of Christ, I have spent my days believing that what He'd have me be is who I am. As I've come to see the weaker side of me, I've realized His grace is what I'll need. When sin demanded justice for my soul, mercy said no. Tried to steal my heart away. Thank you, Jesus. Mercy said no. Oh, yeah. God so loved the world that He sent His Son to save us. From the cross He built a bridge to set us free. Oh, but deep within our hearts, there is still a war that rages and makes a sacrifice so hard to see. As midnight fell on crucifixion day, the light of hope seemed oh so far away. As evil tried to stop redemption's flow, mercy said no.
The Lord strong and mighty, He is.
Lord strong and mighty.
to him we sing, King of Glory.
Who is this King of Glory?
The Lord God mighty he
is. Lord strong and mighty.
The Lord God mighty in battle.
Lord God mighty in battle.
None powerful as him. To him we sing.
Hallelujah.
Glory. Your name. Thank you, Lord, for all you've done for me. I was bound until you set me free. Thank you, Lord. Victoria and powerful and glorious. Said you're mighty. Victoria and powerful. Calling up your name, said you're mighty, you're mighty, Victoria, all powerful and glorious. Said you're mighty, Victoria, all powerful and glorious. Said you're mighty, you're mighty. You're mighty, mighty to heal, mighty to save, mighty to deliver. You're mighty, yeah. Hallelujah. You're welcome. welcome at grace. Find love at grace. Spread peace at grace. Find joy at grace. Said you're welcome here. All are welcome here. We welcome you to Grace Congregation.
Let us pray. The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. Even though I walk through the dark valley of life and death, I will not be afraid, because you are close beside me, guarding and guiding along the way. On this Communion Sunday, we can say that we are grateful for all the blessings and mercies you have shown us. You have kept us and comforted us throughout each day. It seems when relative peace abounds in one part of the world, war jumps up in another, and we are caught up again. The nations of the world claim to want to broker peace for the underdog, but there is so much to do. Only your hand can solve this, and so we pray for the people of Ukraine as we continue to pray for Nigeria, South Sudan, Syria, Afghanistan, Ethiopia, and so many more. We pray for an end to the violence and crime here at home. During this Lenten season, we must renew our relationship with you and meditate on that which you present before us. Dear Lord, please continue to bless this house. Continue to bless all who hear your voice and enter this worship service with you in your glory and power. Strengthen the leadership you have appointed and make their actions reflect only your will. This is our prayer at this time. In the matchless name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Welcome, welcome, welcome. In here, out there, and around the world, welcome to Grace Congregational Church of Harlem. We are here celebrating and honor our Christ, and we've come to praise him and to worship him and to honor who Christ is. And so as we celebrate this morning, we are also mindful of the prayers that must go out to the Ukrainian people and for their courage and for their stamina and for all there is. We pray for peace. We pray for this whole world as it comes together against tyranny and against evil. We are certainly mindful that Dr. King wrote a book called Are We Headed Toward Chaos or Community? And this is an important moment and an understanding. Are we truly headed for chaos or community? And so our prayers are lifted up for all those in harm's way, those who have to leave their home, those who be needing work for food and clothing and shelter. And our prayers go out for everyone. We have started this week with Ash Wednesday. That was last Wednesday, and we begin and continue every morning with our devotional prayer at 6 a.m. And so First Lady and I have been here and doing the rosary and spending 20, 25 minutes in prayer in the church, praying for this church and our community and for this world and for our leaders. And so we take this moment, in this moment, for 40 days to pray. You know, folks have said, what are you giving up for Lent? And it's not so much what I'm giving up. It is what I'm doing to allow me to just be in contemplative prayer and allow me to enter into the throne room of God is what's important in this moment, these 40 days, which emulate the 40 days that Jesus spent in the desert prior to starting his ministry and his work here on earth. Amen. We are celebrating Women's History Month, which is important because they have been the matriarchs, they have been the cornerstone, the backbone of churches, the backbones of many movements, the backbones of our home. You know, the Monahan Report had come out and said, the problem with the black family is that the woman is in charge. And had they understood that in Africa, the queen mother was in charge. She was the one that selected the king. She was the one that was in the center of every village. And so we understand the power of the woman, and especially the power of the black woman. And so we celebrate all women on this month for all they have done and all they have done to help us become who we are. Amen. To help us celebrate Women's History Month, Reverend Dr. Erica Dunbar will be our preacher next week. She comes from Atlanta, Georgia. She is the adjunct professor at Spelman College, and she received her biblical studies in Old Testament in May 2020 from Drew University. Recently, she has published a book about the sex trafficking in the book of Esther. And so here we will have her as our speaker, and I believe First Lady will also have her speaking as a guest as well, because that is such a difficult topic to talk about, but something we must continue because we realize it's still a problem in this world. Amen. If you're celebrating a birthday, an anniversary, please let us know. We want to celebrate with you. But we celebrate the March birthdays and the following people: April Dixon, Yolanda Ford, Leonard Johnson, Ralph Johnson, First Lady Lisa Pierce, amen, Antoinette Rodriguez, Eglin Simons, Merlin Smith, and Ellen Snyder. And if you're celebrating anything this month, please let us know, because maybe you're just celebrating life, and some of us just need to celebrate life each and every day. God bless you, and enjoy today's service. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We've come to give God's name thanks and praise, because truly he is deserving. Hallelujah. We find it not robbery to pour out praises unto your name. We want you to be glorified in this earth, oh God. Hallelujah. In this time of trouble, we lift up, oh God, your name, oh God, because only your name can cure. Only your name can see. Only your name, oh God, can cure anything that's going wrong in the world. Be glorified in this place, oh God. Hallelujah to your name. We bless your name, oh God. Hallelujah. The lyrics say, be glorified. And we're going to glorify your name right now. Hallelujah. Come on, help me out, sing. Be glorified.
Be glorified. Be glorified.
You deserve the praise. You deserve the glory. And we give you glory, God. Be glorified in the heavens.
Amen, amen, amen. We have been in a series with the gospel and the book of John, but now we want to do a little mini-series inside of a series called I Am. You know, there are seven I Am statements in the book of John. I am the good shepherd, the light of the world, the resurrection and the life. I am the way and the truth and the life. I am the bread of life. I am the true vine. And I am the door. These are the great I Am statements that Jesus makes about himself, a declaration to who he is, and it perfectly understanding how we need him in our lives. As we continue to progress through the Lenten season on our way to the cross, this is the best way to understand who Jesus says he is and who he is. Corrie ten Boom, a Dutch Christian, said it probably best when she was the one who was hiding Jews from Hitler's Holocaust. She said it so beautifully. She said, "You may never know that Jesus is all you need until Jesus is all you have. You may never know that Jesus is all you need until Jesus is all you have." And so this morning, we want to make sure you understand who Jesus is when he says, "I am the bread of life." I'm taking them a little out of order because today is Communion Sunday, and I thought how appropriate that we ought to talk about, "I am the bread of life," as Jesus says. And so I take you to the text this morning, John 6, 32 to 35, "The bread of life." "Then Jesus said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, Moses gave you not the bread from heaven, but my Father giveth you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he which cometh down from heaven and giveth light and life unto the world. Then said they unto him, Lord, evermore, give us this bread. And Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst. Amen. For this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God." Let us pray. Father God, Mother God, Holy Spirit, as we bombard the heavens with our prayers and with our faith, send down your Holy Spirit. Send down a fresh anointing so we may receive, thus saith the Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. This is a saying. The whole chapter 6 is an important and a very important chapter in the book of John because it talks about the famous feeding of the 5,000, the bread that is given to those 5,000. And so this morning I want to talk about the bread of life, how it is bread for your mind, bread for your body, and bread for your heart. I am the bread of life, Jesus says, for our mind, that it engages our intellect and helps us to think about who Jesus is. And the bread of life also is nourishment not only for our bodies, but for our spirituality and our spirit, because in our Father we say, "Give us our daily bread." And what does that mean, and what are we asking for? And also bread for our heart. What is at the center of our lives, the center of who we are and the center of what we believe, it is at the heart. And so it's bread for the heart. Let us talk about the bread for the mind. The miracle points to us proof that Jesus is the great I am. These famous miracles, this is the only miracles that is in all four gospels of all books. And so he's going to the other side of the lake. He has already fed the 5,000 and he is running away from the people. And it's a remote part of the lake. And he's trying to get away from these 5,000. And here they are, the day is late, and they're a long way from home. And Jesus says to the disciples, one of these disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said unto him, there is a lad here which has 5 barley loaves and 2 small fishes, but what are they among so many? And so here we have the miracle of the feeding of 5,000. Jesus feeds them, and he is able to, as Reverend Dr. Maurice Wallace came and preached during the summer, after they were all done, they sent the 12 baskets out to pick up the crumbs. And so the next day, they are looking for Jesus. They're looking for the Messiah. They're calling him to make him the king. And they're looking to the one who fed them. And they're saying, do it again. Do what you did before. The miracle that you performed yesterday. Make more bread. Do it here and now. And that was the evidence for them that he was the Messiah, that he was the king. Because if somebody who can bend nature, break the way that things ought to flow, it ought to be the Creator who created all things, because God, who uses his creative power, can also renew, restore, and resurrect life. He can change the course of history and change the way things ought to happen, because we understand through physics and quantum mechanics and chaos theory that certainly the things that stitch this planet together can only be undone by the one who created it. He can walk on water. He can heal the sick. He can give sight back to the blind. He can stop the wind and the rain. And so maybe this morning you're skeptical about miracles. Maybe this morning you're saying it's only urban legends. It's only a myth. Maybe this morning you're saying that miracles don't prove anything. And Jesus says, you are absolutely right. Miracles don't prove anything. And so when folks, you heard, when the miracles happened and they were looking for the Messiah, they were saying to him, do it again, do it again. And Jesus does not perform the same miracle again. For he says to them, Jesus answers them, very truly I tell you, you were looking for me, not because you saw the signs I performed, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For on him, God the Father, was placed his seal of approval. For on him, God the Father has placed his seal of approval. And so when they ask for them to do the miracle again, he says he won't do the miracle again, because it's not the miracles that we ought to be following. The miracles were not just a demonstration of power, but a way for you to think about who was the one who was doing the miracles. Right? Jesus didn't come to perform magic shows. The crowd said, do it again. And he said, you need to look for the bread of life. And that's why when Jesus responds in verse 32, I am the bread of life. I am the miracle you've been looking for. And when we get down to verse 35, and that's why Jesus said, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth in me shall never thirst. And so Jesus is telling them who he is, that you ought to look at the miracles as the one who is the miracle worker, the miracle giver, the great I am. And this morning, we look no further than to look at Jesus, Don't get distracted with the miracles. Don't run off with the miracles, but sit with the miracle worker, for he says, I am the bread of life, the one who comes from heaven. He even invokes Moses, saying that Moses, the manna that came from heaven, that manna came from heaven. It didn't come from the hand of Moses. And so when you were in the desert for 40 years, that manna from heaven every day came from God the Father. And so if miracles start to happen, don't get distracted with the miracles. Go and run to the miracle worker. If miracles were to start happening at Grace Church, you wouldn't just come to the Grace Church, you'd be coming to Jesus. If miracles start happening by some pastor, you don't run to the pastor, you run to Jesus, who is the miracle giver, because that is what we look for. That's what ought to stimulate you intellectually. Who is the one that made the mountains and the earth and the sea and the stars? Who is the one that can walk on water? Who is the one that can change water into wine? That is evidence that Jesus says who he is. But he is saying, look at me. Look at my story. Look at what I have said about who I am. That is what we're to pay attention to. Not the bread, not the wine, not the fire, not the walking on water, and not the rain and the wind being stopped. But look at the miracle giver, who is the one who gives us who he is. And so many of us, when we were desperately seeking a miracle in our lives, and we wanted a miracle. Can you be honest this morning? Can someone be honest this morning? Can I get a witness this morning? You wanted a miracle in your life instead of wanting the one who was giving you the miracle. Instead of wanting the one who's giving you a miracle. You were desiring a miracle. You wanted a miracle. You needed a miracle. And when you got the miracle in your life, you ran off with the miracle. Amen. You prayed for a husband. You prayed for a wife. And that was, you got your miracle. And that's the last time Jesus saw you. Amen. We got to be honest this morning, because we're praying to the Father. We're praying to Jesus. And when a miracle happens in our life, what are you praying for? And have you forgotten the one who gave you the miracle of life? Because this morning, that's what we ought to focus on. Not the miracles, not the things that have happened, but actually the one who makes them happen. I'm reminded of a man who came to Manhattan, and he was driving round and round and round looking for a parking space, couldn't find a parking space. He said, Lord God, if you would just give me a parking space, I would come to church every Sunday. I'd go to church. I'd be the first one there every Sunday. All of a sudden, a parking space opened up. He said, never mind, I'm good, and pulls into the parking space. How many of us forgot who gave us the miracle? How many forgot when we got what we were looking for, when we got what we wanted, we forgot about the person of Jesus Christ who gave it to us. Amen? And so this morning, miracles don't really change hearts and minds, but it ought to give you an idea of who Jesus is, and it ought to point you back to the miracle worker. And so it makes you think. That's bread for the mind. But bread for the body, it is also, when Jesus says, I am bread of life, he is also bread for the body, because it ought to be the way you show up in this world ought to change when you are feeding on the bread of life, because miracles are proof positive that he is who he says that he is, but it ought to point you in a very different direction than the way you were going. So this morning, I could think of a whole lot of different ways that Jesus could have used his miraculous powers. He could have rained down bread from heaven. He could have had his angels serve everyone bread. He could have did cartwheels in the sky and all kind of miraculous things. He could have wiped out the Romans and just knocked out the enemy and showed them how powerful he truly was. But he didn't do that. See, if you and I had power like that, we'd use it for ourselves. We would use it to show how great and how special we are. But when Jesus has this magnificent creative power, he uses it to heal the sick and to feed the hungry. He uses it to give those who are blind sight. He uses it to give those who are in desperate need of healing and help. And so this morning, when we ask the question, why does God allow suffering in this world? We may not know the whole answer to that, but what we do know is he hates suffering. What we do know is that every miracle that he performed was an assault against the suffering in this world, against death, dread, and disease in this world, against pain and suffering in this world. And so when John the Baptist says, are you the one, or should we look for another? He says, I've come so that the blind may see. So he was against physical brokenness. He says, I've come that the lepers be cleansed. So that he was against spiritual alienation. He was against not letting, you know, the lepers weren't allowed to come into a house of worship. And he was against that. And he cleansed the lepers. He said, I come to set the captives free. Those in bondage. Yes, some were in chains, but there are people who are walking around that are in bondage and need to be set free. He said, the poor have good news. For he says, what do you do to the least of my brothers, you have done unto me. And so God hates the injustice in the world. God uses his power to put back to the natural order of things. And that's important this morning, that we think about how are we using our power? How are we using our strength in this world? I like what Jürgen Moltmann said. He said, Jesus' healings are not supernatural miracles in a world, in a natural world. They are the only natural thing in a world that is unnatural, demonized, and wounded. Jesus' healings are not supernatural miracles in a natural world. They are the only true natural thing in a world that is unnatural, demonized, and wounded. And so when we see miracles, we are seeing things put back into the order that Jesus put them in and created them in. We are seeing the world the way it ought to be. We are seeing the things, for we know that God did not create hunger. God did not create the children with the large bellies, swollen stomachs. God did not do that. But this world has, and we have done that in the name of human beings treating other human beings less than human beings and children of God. And so this morning, God heals the blind. God resurrects the dead. For God is looking back at Eden and knowing the perfect world that he created, and also looking ahead at the perfect and the kingdom and the new heaven and the new earth that he is creating for us, where there is no more pain, no more suffering, and no more dying. The physical, the sociological, the psychological, and the spiritual are all healed in Jesus. And so when he says, I am the great I am the bread of life. Come feed on me, because in every area of your life, it is important that we be careful about how we use our power. Because James Baldwin said it so eloquently when he said, it is certain in any case that ignorance allied with power is the most ferocious enemy justice can have. This was written before January 6th. This was written before any of the things that we're experiencing today happen. But when he wrote that, how powerful is that? That power and ignorance is the most ferocious enemy we have against justice. And so this morning, we must think about, how am I using my power? Am I truly healing this world? Am I doing all that I can to help this world be a better place than it truly is? And so this morning, we have to think about how we're using our power. Because Jesus says in John 14, very truly I tell you, whoever believes in me will do works of greater things, greater than I have done, because I'm going back to the Father. And you're wondering, how can we do better than Jesus? I mean, he took a poor lad's lunch, just 5 loaves and 2 fishes, and fed 10, 15, 20,000 people in one sitting. Well, here's how we do it, because we can do today. The World Kitchen by Jose Andres. He is one of a world-class chef who has decided to send chefs out throughout the world to help with the problem of hunger. For he says, food is not a luxury. He says it is reserved not just for the lucky, it is a universal human right, and that no one should live in hunger. And so he has raised over $1 billion. And so when Brazil had their 30 days of rain and flood and many things were destroyed, he sent chefs down to serve food for over hundreds and hundreds of thousands. He sent chefs to Madagascar when there were cyclones. And so now he is sending chefs to Ukraine to help feed the people there. And he has raised $1 billion to help feed hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people. So when Jesus says greater things that we can do, we can put together resources to help so many more people than we're helping now. What are we to do in our space? What are we to do with our power? What are we to do with our strength? And so some of you are skeptical and sitting on the fence and saying, well, I don't really need Jesus to do good. And so I ask you, how do you justify your good? Because what we see in the world is the unwinding of the world. We're seeing decay and disease and death and the clock ticking as the world winds down. What can you say? I mean, most of this we would say is Darwinism and the progression of what is happening in this world. The only thing to undo that, and the only thing you know that can undo that, is that there something must be bigger than us. Something must be greater than us. And there must be a God who can do and undo the sickness and disease and the injustice that is in the world. It is only God's power that can restore, renew, and to resurrect. So the world is unnatural. And we know that God has a natural, beautiful world for us to create and to live in. And that is the world we must create. As Christians, what are we doing about injustice? As Christians, what are we doing about the suffering in the world? As Christians, what are we doing? For we ought to model our lives after Jesus, thinking about the hope that we can create, thinking about how we can relieve the suffering in this world. The feeding, Jesus took a poor lad's lunch, 5 barleys and 2 loaves. Barley was the cheapest grain there is, and so it was a poor boy's lunch that he took, a little lad's lunch that he took. It was a sign that we are to involve the poor in the feeding and in the helping of creating the new kingdom, because we must partner with them. We must learn from them. We must treat them because they have something to offer and something to say, and we must honor what they have to offer. So this morning, it is bread for the mind. It ought to be thinking about how this miracle and miracles in the Bible point to Jesus being the great I am. It is bread for your body, not just physically, but spiritually. Give us our daily bread. We ought to be feeding on Jesus' spirituality every day so that we can be this strength, given the strength and the courage to do what God has called us to do. But it also is bread for the heart. It ought to convert you to become the person that you would have never become without Jesus. It ought to shake up your world. It ought to turn your world upside down, because the things Jesus said were so radical that it ought to change your life, because he made some radical claims. He made some claims that were so different that we would have to, if we heard them, it would change our lives. And so this morning, if we go to verse 53, you will see there that Jesus shakes up things and disciples start walking away from him. He says, Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day. For my flesh is real food, and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats of my flesh and drinks of my blood remains in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, I live because of the Father. So the one who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Your ancestors ate manna and died, but whoever feeds on this bread will live forever. You can just imagine the people saying, Jesus, we were with you when you changed water into wine. We were with you when you walked on water. We were with you when you fed the 5,000. But now you're talking some craziness now about feeding and flesh and drinking blood. What are you talking about? And it says disciples began to walk away from him. We don't know how many he had. All we know is 12 were left behind at the end of the day. Amen? And so he even turns to Peter and he says, Peter, do you want to leave too? And Peter says, I don't have anywhere else to go. I don't have anywhere to go. And so not that he understood what Jesus was saying, but he hung around long enough, and John hung around long enough so that they could write the gospel and so that they could understand what he was talking about. And so if you're offended, if you don't understand, hang around long enough. Try to grasp what he's saying, because the spiritual hunger is in each and every one of us. We are to feed, for Jesus says, don't labor for the bread that spoils, but work for that bread that is eternal life. And so we're looking and searching this morning for our spiritual hunger to be fed. You put anything else in the center of your life, even family, food, comfort, anything else will leave you short, because it will not fulfill the promises that Jesus Christ has given us. And so this morning, at the heart of the matter is, what do you have at the center of your life? If it's not the bread of life, if it's not Jesus, then it's something else that won't be able to fulfill you and satisfy you, as Jesus is speaking about. For Jesus is saying, I am the bread of life. He is unique. He is different than anything else. He speaks. He is saying, I, me, mine, 17 times in this verse. You would think that someone who spoke like that would be egocentric. Somebody who spoke like that, how could they possibly change the world? And yet he says that if you don't eat this bread, you will not have eternal life. You will starve eternally. And so that's how critical it is this morning. He is not only the ultimate person, but he is the broken person, because he uses the metaphor bread. And you have to understand this morning that the only way to get bread is to take wheat and to crush it and to grind it and to pulverize it and then put it in the oven. You put yeast on it so that it may rise. That is the process that bread must go through. And so Jesus saying, I am the bread of life. I am torn down from you. I am pummeled. I am smashed. I am crushed. And I am broken. And I was put into the oven of hell just for you, so that you wouldn't have to go through all that. And so this morning, Jesus is not just the guide, but Jesus is life itself. And you get life when you believe in Jesus. Not someone just showing you a way. Not someone just letting you know, here, have some bread. He is saying, I am the bread of life. And so this claim is astonishing. How this morning can this one person who walked planet Earth be the one who is behind creation? For as we learned, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. And the power behind the universe was Christ himself. It's hard to wrap our minds around that. It's hard to understand how this could be the bread for the world that we all need to eat and all need to feed on. But I'm reminded what George Whitefield used to do. He's an Anglican priest from the 18th century, and he used to say this: go and learn what this meaneth. He would end every sermon with that verse. And he would say, go learn. Go and learn what this meaneth. Meaning, he was not confused. He didn't think that he was teaching the verse. He was only introducing you to a thought and the verse. And that's what I feel like I'm doing today. Only introducing you to the verse. Only introducing to the thought of what it would be like if Jesus was the bread of life for you and in your life. You have to wrestle with it. You have to knead that into your life and see what that feels like and what that would mean for your life if Jesus was the only way, the truth, and the light in your life. If he was that bread of life for you, what would that look like for you? How would that change you? Because Jesus said, you know, Philip, feed them. And Philip said, how can we feed them? It's confounding, because how can we do anything without God this morning? Because we're like that poor lad. We show up to life with our 5 loaves and our 2 fishes and don't think we can do much. But with God's help, with God's power, with God's strength, we can change this world. And so this morning, we have to understand that I didn't think. It wasn't until I realized I was a bad husband that I became a good husband. It wasn't until I realized I was a bad father that's how I became a good father. And that is the first step. If you had a 12-step program, the first step is to realize we are powerless against some of the greatest problems of our life, and we need the power of God to get us. I could only be a better husband with the power of God in my life. I could only be a better father, because where would forgiveness and love and the capacity that I do not have come from unless it came from the power of God? And so this morning, I want you to recognize, I think John Nelson Darby, who is a spiritual teacher, said this, when you get into your nothingness, that's when you get out of it. It's when you realize that you're nothing without God. You're nothing without the power of God and the breath of the Holy Spirit in your life. Is when you stop thinking that you're something that you truly believe become the something that God created you to be. And that's the principle. And so sometimes we have to get into our nothingness in order to get out of it. And so God may be showing us that we're a bad friend or a bad husband or a bad wife so that he can show us how to be a better one, how we can grow to be the God-like child that he has created us to be. And so when God shows us our inadequacies, it's only to show us that we could do so much more with him, right? Because we're just the lad showing up with the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes. But with God, we can feed the multitudes. And that's what we have to understand this morning, that Jesus is the bread of life. That when Father looks at Jesus and sees what he has done, that's the record that we have inherited this morning, that we don't have the miserable record of what we have done in our lives, but we inherit the beautiful record that Jesus does on the cross and what he did for us in Calvary. If we can see that this morning, we pass from death to eternal life. What could be more important than eternal life? What could be more important than that gift at the center of our life is Jesus Christ? If that's the thing that we do. And so when we pray through the Lenten season, we do 7 Our Fathers in the morning, and we say, give us our daily bread. What is the bread that you're asking for? Is the bread that goes stale and dies, or is it the bread that is for eternity, that spiritual bread that gives us all that we need to be all that we can be in this world? And so this morning, I implore you to feed on Jesus and to make Jesus the bread of life. He is the great I am. And as George Whitefield would say, go and learn it, what this meaneth. Amen.
God of creation, there at the start. of reference. You spoke to the dark and fleshed out the wonder of light. And as you speak, 100 billion galaxies are born. In the vapor of your breath, stars were made to worship, so alive. I can see your heart and everything you've made. Every burning star a signifier of grace. If creation sings your praises, so will I. So will I. God of your promise, you don't speak in vain, no syllable empty or void. For once you have spoken, all nature and science follow the sound of your voice. And as you speak, 100 billion creatures catch your breath, evolving in pursuit of what you I can see your heart and everything you say. Every painted sky, a canvas for your grace. If creation still obeys you, so will I. So so I could find it here. If you left the grave behind you, so will I. I can see your heart and everything you've done. Every part you signed, a work of art called love. If you gladly chose surrender, so will I. I can see your heart, it built in different ways. Every precious one, a child you died to save. If you gave your life to save them, so will I. So will I. So will I. You're the one who never leaves the one behind.
Father God, we come to you at this moment with gratitude in our hearts for all that you have done for us. And how can we repay you when you have given us everything and sacrificed all for us? And so, Lord God, it is only with a heart of thanksgiving that we give back to you. And so, God bless you. God bless you in your giving. Amen.
Just wanna praise you forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. Oh, just wanna praise you forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. Oh, just wanna praise you forever and ever. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me over and over again. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. Oh, thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him Father, Son, and Holy.
Father God, we thank you for these offerings, for you have given us everything yourself. And so we ask that you take these gifts, multiply them, and allow them to be used for the purposes of your kingdom here on earth. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Today's communion ought to be different when you understand the Trinity a little bit more. And so let us do the prayer of confession. Loving God, you have come to us, yet we confess that we often refuse to receive you. We live in a world as if we don't know you. Forgive us, Lord. Give us a new heart. Give us a heart of love. Give us a heart that serves you. Write your words upon our hearts. Make yourself known to us as we live each and every day. We pray to you, O Lord, for you have revealed yourself to us in so many ways. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Be of good courage, for God sent his Son into the world not to condemn the world, but to save us. I say to you in the name of Jesus Christ, your sins have been forgiven. And the people responded, through the power of the Holy Spirit, let us live as children of God. Amen. We are so grateful that we have gathered at the communion table again, that God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit invite us to this table. Let us pray. God of power, God of peace, God of love, God of healing, who feed the hungry and calm the storms. You comfort those who are trembling. Call your children to this table. Call your children into your arms. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Those who come and eat and drink of this bread and this wine will not hunger, and neither will they thirst. The God who loves you, the God who redeems us, the God who cares for us in so many special ways is the same God that calls us to this table this morning so that we may enjoy these earthly gifts. We ask them to embolden our heart. Give us courage and strength, Lord, to serve you the way we were designed to serve you and one another. Lord God, as we recall on the words that were spoken that night, that you received from the Lord and were handed down. On the night he was betrayed, he took a loaf of bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it, and said, this is my body, which has been given up for you. By the same token, on the same evening, he took the cup of the everlasting blessings and said, as often as you do drink of this cup, do think of me until I come again. Ministering unto you, I give you these gifts. Amen.
His blood still works, and I'm glad to report that it's never lost its power. Yes, it works. I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Help me sing. His blood still works, and I'm glad to report that it never lost its power. Testify that God is not dead, he is still alive. Same blood that was shed way back on Calvary. is the same blood that's working out for me. His blood redeems me from the stain of sin. His blood cleanses me way down within. So if you ask me how I made it and how I've overcome, I can tell you it's because of the blood. His blood still works, and I'm glad to report that it's never lost its power. Yes, it works. I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Oh, oh, the blood of Jesus.
Join us as we partake of the wonderful bread of life. For it says we cannot live alone by bread, but only of every word that is spoken out of God's mouth. And so let us partake of the bread of life. The cup of everlasting blessings, let us partake of the blood that was spilled for you and for me, the blood and the water that came out of the side of Jesus to show us the cost of our redemption. Let us drink from the cup of everlasting blessings. Gracious, loving, bountiful God, we give thanks for you have gathered us here with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, that we may feel and understand how much you love us and how much you care for us this day. We thank you for the strength and the love that you give us at this table. We thank you for increasing our love for one another at this table. We thank you for sending us forth into this world, radiating with your love and with your faith and with your hope. And we gather at this table. Let us learn to dance at this table. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now let us pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and deliver us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. God is the kingdom and the power and the glory is yours, now and forever. Amen.
I thought it was only appropriate to end Black History Month with a bang and to kick off Women's History Month with a bang with a poem by my dear friend. I'm going to call it untitled for the moment, but it's by my dear friend, Shadina Shavad. Being black was known to be a sin. Pants sagging low, b-balling above the rim. All we known to do is play basketball and leave the education to them. And then they lock us behind bars for not telling. Is that a sin? All our men are known to be our players, pimps, and no good daddies, identified by skin that's dark and hair that's nappy. Well, being black is an art from God. Some say he ran out of white. But I'm proud to be black because I can see the true beauty in night. Martin Luther King had a dream. We just need to color it. I'll paint it with my voice and prove I'm not illiterate. If Malcolm X wanted us to get our fists bloody, well, then that's just what we'll do. Because some things are worth fighting for, like being able to sit by you. Throughout all our struggles, civil rights still remains a dent. They laugh and joke and call me ignorant, but who you know could buy 10 things with 50 cents? 10 to a house, 3 to a bed, taking a bath with your cousin and a pillow with 2 heads. We just want our pride and dignity because that's just what they took. They laugh and joke and call us ignorant, but we the main ones writing books. They said Rosa Parks was lazy. That's why she didn't give a seat up on the bus. But we did the Million Man March. So what they know about us? There is no such thing as Black History Month because every day is ours. I was born black and I'm still black to this hour. And throughout all our struggles, I am still an American figure. And I'm the genius because everything I said was real and not once did I use the word.
Ring with God.
May the grace of God and the sweetest communion of the Holy Spirit and the love of Jesus Christ rest, rule, and abide in every household of faith, now and forevermore. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, Grace Church said, Amen. May you go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.